Recently, we released optimized locking in Azure SQL Database, but have you heard of it? And do you know how it can make your life easier? Learn all about it this week on Data Exposed MVP Edition. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, I'm joined by a regular, John Morehouse, usually in Star Wars attire, but not today. John, we're super excited to have you joining us today. Can you tell us, for folks who don't know, a little bit about what you do?
About what I do? Well, thank you very much for having me. I love coming to these recordings and presenting. I am a principal consultant with Denny Cherry Associates, And I've been there for about 6.5 years, going on 7. And I do a lot of cool things with SQL Server, ranging from being a DBA for our clients and or doing Azure migrations to, you know, Azure SQL Database or managed instance or whatever their needs are.
Awesome. Cool. Well, we're excited to have you on the show. You are a true SQL expert, and we're excited today to be learning about something I don't know a ton about and is relatively recent. So let's take it away before I won't give it away, but like, what are some scenarios that led to this thing?
So this is, we're going to talk about optimized locking. And this is, and you're right, this is pretty new. Microsoft has been working on it for a while. It's actually out live today, and Microsoft actually kind of snuck it under the window. So not a lot of people are talking about it. So that's why I wanted to talk about it. And one of the things that we struggle with today as data professionals is that SQL Server by nature, and I've got some slides that I'm going to kind of reference, is pessimistic by nature. So if you're running SQL Server, there are some things you can do to make it less pessimistic, but generally it's pessimistic by nature. And what that means is that when we modify data, we have to take locks on things, and those things are like tables and pages and rows, to ensure that those changes are done effectively and consistently and they don't cause other problems, right? Because those locks are taken, not all the locks are compatible with each other. So as multiple people are modifying data at the same time, it can cause blocking, which results in frustrations. If you've been in a DBA or data professional role, I would bet you that most people have run into this problem where, and of course, it's always with a C-level suite person where they need to get a report or insert data, like bonus data for their DBAs, and it causes blocking. We can't get it done. So in today's world, here's an example of what happens today, right, in SQL Server. So I've got a table here, T1. I'm going to insert some values, basically 3 rows, an ID of 1, 2, and 3 with value, an age value of 10, 20, and 30. In today's world, if I have a session come in and they start a transaction, and we're going to update that table and change the age and increment it by 10. You can see here that we have a lock manager down below, and the lock manager is what controls the locking mechanism in SQL Server when we make data modifications. We first have to get some locks. I kind of mentioned it earlier. The first thing that we have to do is essentially get a lock on the table. Then we have to get a lock on the actual data page where the data lives that we're going to modify. And then we get a lock on the actual row. The locks on the left, the X means it's an exclusive lock, meaning that transaction is the only thing that can touch that data at that moment in time. But if I have another session come in and they need to modify data as well, they also start a transaction and they are going to try to modify another row. In the first one, they are trying to modify where ID equals 1. In this session, they're going to modify the row where ID equals 2. If we follow the lock mechanism, we still get a lock on the table. We still get a lock on the page, but you'll notice that this lock is what's called an intent update. Mm-hmm. It intends to update data on this data page. And then we get an update lock on the row, but it can't continue because the first session hasn't finished. It hasn't committed that transaction, and the second session has nowhere to go. And so this is a very common thing that we see in the wild today is multiple transactions coming in and things get blocked. And so handling this can get really frustrating at times. Essentially what that means is if we update large amounts of data, we have to get a large amount number of locks potentially, and those locks are held for the entire duration of that transaction. So, and so that can be painful and it can be very, very frustrating.
Yeah.
Now, with optimized locking that was released, they actually changed the mechanism in terms of how the locks are held. With optimized locking, they've changed the way that this is kind of handled. And one of the things they introduced was the concept of locking the actual transaction at a higher level, right? So we actually hold that lock for the entire duration of the transaction, but that allows us to move around the locks in a better sequence to help reduce some of this blocking. The other thing that they introduced was a new concept called lock after qualification. In today's world, when we lock things up, we lock everything and it stays locked until we're done. Okay. With lock after qualification, we actually evaluate the data based off the predicate or the where clause to make sure that we actually need to lock it. So if the where clause isn't satisfied, we don't lock it. And then we do move on to the next row. And, you know, so it goes forth, you know, in sequence. And therefore, if there's no locks to be held, we're not causing any blocking. The other really cool part is that if the predicate is satisfied, meaning that, yep, we have the right row and we're going to modify data in that row, then those locks on that row are released as soon as that update is completed. So now we don't have to wait for the entire transaction to be done and committed or rolled back. We can actually release that lock and not cause any blocking. So if we look at
that, quick question for you, John. Sure. Does that introduce any extra overhead?
So good question. So one of the things with traditional locking is that locking takes memory. So it does take some resources to facilitate that. With optimized locking, we actually reduce the locking memory footprint. So we're actually reducing our compute consumption a little bit by using optimized locking. There is some thought that optimized locking might take a little bit longer in terms of duration for the transaction. But in generally that the locking memory is going to be less. So we're actually reducing overhead with optimized locking.
Cool.
I think it's fascinating. And I think this is something that DBAs should pay attention to. Because right now it's only an Azure SQL Database, but eventually I hope that it comes to the box product for on-premise implementation. I think this could be one of those game changers, but I digress. So let's look at optimized locking real quick. Same kind of similar scenario. I've got a table. I'm going to insert the exact same values. I have a session. I'm going to start a transaction. I'm going to update the age by 10, increment it by 10, where row ID equals 1. If we look at the lock manager, one of the first things you'll notice that we have an additional exclusive lock on that specific transaction. That transaction comes with an ID, so they call it a TID or a transaction ID. And so we put an exclusive lock on that transaction itself. But everything else is pretty much the same. We still get the locks on the table and the page, and we get an exclusive lock on that row. Our subsequent session comes in, same thing, starts a transaction, going to update the same table, but it's looking for the row where ID equals 2. We still get an exclusive lock, but this is going to have its own transaction ID. So we're actually got two exclusive locks, but they're on two separate transactions. With that now, we still get our intent exclusive locks on the table and page, but now we actually get the lock after qualification. It finds row where ID equals 2. That satisfies that predicate, that where clause. And so therefore it can place the X or the exclusive lock on that actual row. So now I've got two transactions that both have exclusive locks on the data that they need, and they're no longer blocked. I think this is really, really cool.
Nice.
And what that means is that we still might need a million locks, but those locks are released as soon as that update gets done. So, and only that one transaction lock is going to be needed until the end of the transaction. There are some gotchas with this. It does require accelerated database recovery, which is technology that I absolutely love. And it uses the persistent version store to help maintain the locks and understand what data to change and all that. Read committed snapshot isolation is encouraged, but technically it's not required. we enabling read, commit, and snapshot is one of our go-to. Yes, we recommend it pretty much all the time. I'm not sure why you would turn that off, but and as I mentioned earlier, right now it's only available in Azure SQL Database, but hopefully it'll come to the Box product at some point in time. I have no knowledge whether or not that was true or not, but I hope that it eventually will come in, because as a DBA who's had to battle with blocking and locking for years and years and years, I think this is a phenomenal advancement in changing the game and the landscape for locking and blocking. So I think data professionals everywhere should pay attention to this. Awesome. And it's already live in the wild. You can actually use a database property function to determine whether or not your Azure SQL Database actually has it enabled. And I believe that most, I don't know what the count is, but I know that it's already live in the wild and it is out there. I checked one of my databases in my demo tenant and it's already there. So it's really cool stuff.
Awesome. Well, John, thanks so much for coming on the show. I personally actually learned a lot, had some aha moments there that threw things up a
little
bit. But I really appreciate you coming on the show. I think we're going to put some links in the description for folks to learn more. If you like this episode, go ahead, give it a like, leave us a comment, let us know what you think. Check if your Azure SQL Database has this turned on and see what you think. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed MVP Edition.